Good morning, world. We bid you a wonderful morning as you gather for worship here as we are live streaming from Holy Redeemer Lutheran Church. We thank Jerry for the beautiful flowers on the altar today. We are blessed by that beauty. We thank Lanny and Jack and Jackie and Tracy for leading worship this morning. A friendly reminder, there is a Zoom coffee hour after worship today at 10, so please check the link on the Facebook page and please join in, either by video or by phone, to visit with your friends following worship today. We remember in our prayers many of our congregation, particularly on this morning, we offer our prayers for Jean and Gordy. Jean's mother, Arlene, died on Friday, and so we offer our Christian sympathy as they are in sorrow. Arlene was 101 when she died. There is a private family funeral this afternoon, and we hold them tightly in our prayers today. We continue to pray for Marv, the husband of Loretta, home with hospice care. We remember Lori, the niece of Joyce, coming through surgery and beginning chemotherapy. Continue to pray for Mark, Joanne's nephew. We also join our nation in sorrow at the death of John Lewis. While those among us are grieving and throughout our nation, we celebrate with those who are having birthdays or anniversaries. We celebrate with Tracy, whose birthday is on Tuesday, with Amanda, Dave, Skylar, and Linda. We celebrate anniversaries with Steve and Tammy, James and Jessica, and Harold and Daphne. We hope that you have wonderful celebrations as those occasions come up. Continue to check your emails for more details. If you have anniversaries or birthdays that you would like us to mention, please do email Jeff in the office. Thanks to all of you for your support and your generosity as we gather for worship and continue to sustain our ministry here at Holy Redeemer Church. With all of those words of announcement and celebration and prayer, we begin our worship today. Our gathering hymn is My Hope is Built on Nothing Less, ELW 597. Thank you. the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Let us pray. Faithful God, most merciful Judge, you care for your children with firmness and compassion. By your Spirit, nurture us who live in your kingdom, that we may be rooted in the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
There are no other gods besides God. The word of the Lord does not fail to come to pass. We can trust in God, through whom Israel and we are redeemed. The first reading is from the 44th chapter of Isaiah, verses 6 through 8. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God who is like me. Let them proclaim it. Let them declare and set it forth before me. Who has announced from of old the things to come? Let them tell us what is yet to be. Do not fear or be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? There is no other rock. I know not one. The Lord of the Word. The Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 86, verses 11 through 17 will be spoken alternately. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name.
I will thank you, O Lord my God, with all my heart, and glorify your name forevermore.
For great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the pit of death.
The arrogant rise up against me, O God, and a band of violent people seeks my life. They have not set you before their eyes.
But you, O Lord, are gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and full of kindness and truth.
Turn to me and have mercy on me. Give your strength to your servant and save the child of your handmaid. Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me.
For Paul, true spirituality means that we experience the reality of the Spirit, which enables us to pray as God's children, keeps us in solidarity with creation, and gives us unseen hope that God will liberate us and creation from bondage to death and decay. The second reading is from the 8th chapter of Romans, verses 1 through 11. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay, and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves. We have the first fruits of the Spirit grown inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slaves said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Then Jesus left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." Jesus answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all the causes of sin and evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let everyone who has ears listen." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I have a wee, small, very small dandelion. I was searching for larger ones, but they're hard to find around Cedar Rapids. We tend to think of dandelions as weeds. But in my growing up, somewhere along the way, I believe it was at camp, some camp counselors showed me that if you would find a very large dandelion, often they're growing out in the farmlands and the fields, this stem, if you would take the flower off, becomes something that you can blow as a horn. They have to be very large, and you have to really purse your lips to blow, because they will make this beautiful sound. The larger the stem and the wider the diameter of the stem, the deeper the horn will be. So if you have occasion with your family or folks who are willing to go with you social distance and safe to some farm or field and find a very large dandelion and you take out the flower, experiment and make your own horns out of the stems, and you'll have a very, very loud and noisy, noisy band. This is your invitation as we think about things that are weeds, but that actually, in many ways, can be useful and fun. Be blessed by dandelions. Let us pray. God of all living things, we're blessed with your creation, the beauty of flowers and all the greenery around us that blossoms and gives life in the summertime. Bless us on this day as we feast on the good news of Jesus. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each one of our hearts be acceptable, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. My grandma Grace, that's my dad's mom, from time to time would make dandelion salad. I had never eaten dandelion salad as a kid. I'm not sure that I liked it very much. In fact, I didn't know you could eat dandelion leaves in a salad. However, I loved the flowers, and I picked them for my mom, sometimes a great great bouquets, and we would bring them to her, and she showed us how to hold them under our chin in the sunlight. It would radiate that golden yellow color underneath our chins, and we would delight in these dandelions and the beauty of their color. But eat them? No. I thought they were weeds. I found out, though, that dandelion beans can be eaten, cooked or raw, and they contain a heap of vitamins. What's more, dandelion beans provide a substantial amount of several minerals, including iron and calcium, magnesium and potassium. Who knew? Almost all of the parts of the dandelion are edible and nutritious. Avoid the flower stems, as I was mentioning about how you take them, as they have a white sticky latex in them that has a bit of a laxative effect, as nutritionists will tell us, and I would say when you blow them, those horns out of the stem, the white stuff is pretty bitter, so you don't want to get that in your mouth. The leaves can be eaten, as mentioned, and the lovely bright yellow flowers can be sauteed, fried, or turned into dandelion wine. There are, as I discovered, a lot of recipes on the internet for things made with dandelions. Who knew, right? As we often find out, sometimes the things we think of as weeds are actually useful, or maybe even someone else's delicacy. To each his or her own, I suppose. After last week's gospel parable about the sower and the seeds and all the different kinds of ground and soil, Jesus moves on with another parable about two sowers, one who sowed seeds of wheat, and another sower, the enemy, who sowed weeds, also called tares, that looked like the wheat. Should we pull them out? No, leave them be. Let them grow together, and the reapers will deal with it at the end of the harvest. They'll take the weeds and bundle them together and burn them. Meaning that the weird weeds that look like wheat, also known as evildoers, will get their comeuppance, their just desserts, or however you might understand the treatment in the afterlife. God will deal with them. As for us, we human beings, who seem to love to draw lines in the sand, pronounce judgment about who's in and who's out, we who love to create boxes of inclusion and exclusion, decade after tireless decade, we do this. God must be weary of it all. After all, in the parable of the wheat can only be wheat. And the weeds can only be weeds. They can never change into anything else but what their DNA prescribes. But humans, that's a completely different story. After all, the astounding good news message of Jesus, which is repent, turn around, go God's way, and welcome the good news of God's love, is precisely founded on the hope that we, each one of us, can change. With the love, the grace, and peace of God's love and Jesus, we can be more grace-filled. We can live and walk in the ways of peace. We can love our neighbors, even our enemies, as we love and accept ourselves. This good, astonishing, amazing news of people changing has been lived out time and time again. And nothing is more profound and breathtaking to witness this transformation in human beings. So it was for Elwin Wilson. William Yardley of the New York Times tells the tale of Elwin Wilson, a former supporter of the Ku Klux Klan, who repeatedly made apologies later in his life for racist acts that he committed decades earlier, including the bloody beating of a civil rights worker who later became a member of Congress. It was way back in the spring of 1961. The group known as the Freedom Riders arrived at the Greyhound bus station in Rock Hill, South Carolina, as part of their effort to end segregation in the South. When two Freedom Riders, 21-year-old seminary student John Lewis, who was black, and Albert Bigelow, who was white, entered the waiting area at the bus station that was designated for whites only, they were quickly assaulted by a group of young, angry white men. One of them was Elwin Wilson. Now, John Lewis and Albert Bigelow didn't fight back, and they just declined to press charges, and they went on their way. But over the next 5 decades, John went on to be a prominent civil rights leader. And in 1987, he became a congressman from Georgia. Elwin Wilson said in an interview in 2009 that a friend had asked him, "If you died right now, Elwin, do you know where you would go?" And Elwin said, "I would go to heaven." Elwin had dealt with his hatred for blacks all his adult life. It wasn't something he inherited, he mentioned, nor was taught by his family, but he hung around all the wrong people in his growing up, and he can't even recall who was in that angry mob that day that met the Freedom Riders at the bus station in downtown Rock Hill just a few days to ride through the South. Elwin said, "In 1961, I didn't know who he, John Lewis, was." But in 2009, Elwin said he had an awakening and an epiphany after seeing President Obama take office. Seeking forgiveness, Elwin called the Rock Hill Herald in 2009 to say that he was one of the men who led the bus station beating and that he had committed other violent acts against others and civil rights workers who were holding lunch counter sit-ins. It was only then, in 2009, that Elwin learned that one of the victims had become a member of Congress, Mr. John Lewis of Georgia. So Elwin traveled to Washington, D.C. and met with Mr. Lewis. "I had to," Elwin said. "It was time to meet the man and apologize." When Elwin spoke, John turned to face him and listened. His gaze never wavered from the face of the man who had beaten him so badly that day. John Lewis never did anything but love that man back and forgive him. "I hold no grudge," John said. "Hate is too heavy a burden to bear." John spoke plainly, like the preacher he is, of the fellowship of human beings. "We are all in the family of humankind," he said. "I never had any idea that this would occur. Never, ever thought this would happen," John said. "This shows the power of love, of grace, of people being able to say, 'I'm sorry,' and I deeply appreciate it. This is so meaningful." John said, the man started crying. His son started crying, and I started crying too. After that meeting, the two men made many appearances over the next few years. And then Mr. Elwin Wilson died in March of 2013. Come to find out, Elwin Wilson's middle name was Hope, and Hope was the middle name of his son, whose name is Chris. No one could have predicted or imagined that Elwin Hope Wilson could ever change his hateful and evil ways, but God knows it's possible. As St. Paul wrote, and as Tracy read, as Paul wrote to the Roman church, "For in hope we are saved." Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes in what is seen? Hope, I think, is like the small but bright nightlight we have lit so others can see their way to come home. John Lewis lived and lifted up the light of Christ's love in all that he did and believed the power of God's love could make a difference and change the world, and through him, it did. The Reverend Mr. John Lewis, an ordained Baptist minister and a man of deep and abiding faith in Jesus and the power of God's redeeming, forgiving love, died on Friday at the age of 80. He once wrote, "Release the need to hate, to harbor division, and the enticement of revenge. Release all bitterness. Hold only to love, only to peace in your heart, knowing that the battle of good to overcome evil is already won. And also he said famously, do not get lost in a sea of despair. Be hopeful, be optimistic. Our struggle is not the struggle of one day or one week, a month or a year. It is the struggle of a lifetime. Never, ever be afraid to make some noise and get in good trouble, necessary trouble. On this morning, leave the wheat and the weeds for the reaper to sort out. As for you and for me, let us get into some good trouble and sow hope and peace and forgiveness. And above all, let us lavishly sow out in the world the love of God in Jesus. And in Jesus' name, the church says, amen. Our hymn of the day is We Plow the Fields and Scatter, BLW 681.
He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again,
He ascended into heaven
and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe
in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Build yourselves up on your most holy faith.
Pray in the Holy Spirit.
Keep yourselves in the love of God.
Look forward to the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ.
If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation.
Everything old has passed away. Behold, everything has become new.
God has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Therefore, let us be reconciled to God and to one another.
Gracious God, have mercy on us. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. Uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. To the honor and glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, grant us pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all our sins. Amen. Confident of God's care for us in the midst of the world's sufferings, we join together in the power of the Spirit to pray for the church, the earth, the world, and all who are in need, responding to the words, "Teach us your way," with the phrase, "Lord, hear our prayer." God of the Church, we praise you for sowing the good seed of the gospel throughout the world. And we mourn that, at this time, many Christians cannot assemble to nurture one another for growth in the faith. Tend your people, support bishops, pastors, deacons, and lay readers. Give us strength through your word. Lead schools, colleges, universities, and seminaries to plan appropriately for the fall semester. O God, teach us your way.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of the earth, we praise you for a wondrous creation, and we mourn that many lands and seas are groaning of rebirth. Nurture our green spaces and national parks. Send rain where there is drought. Protect engendered animals from poachers. Show us how to care for your earth and its creatures. O God, teach us your way.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of the nations, we praise you for the good that has been given us in this country. And we mourn that many people here are poor and dispossessed, that we have allowed racism to distort our society, that violence breaks out in our land. Lead us to form communities in which all people are equal and where disputes are settled without violence. Save us from preserving a past that has been harmful to many. Bring an end to warfare around the world, and mend the torn fabric of humankind with your truth and mercy. O God, teach us your way.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of humankind, we praise you for wherever health and happiness prevail, and we mourn that many people suffer. Each day thousands more contract the virus. Renters are facing eviction. Medical workers are exhausted. Some of the sick have no access to health care. Countless people are broken by sorrows. Open our hearts to your children who suffer in any way, especially Mark, Lori, Marv, Shannon, Helen, Jacob, Colleen, John, Joy, Robert, Marcia, Connie, Sarah, Joshua, Diane, Rachel, Pat, Deanna, Rhonda Lee, Gary, Susan, and Max, and show us how to serve them. Let us also pray for our Stephen Ministry care receivers and caregivers, as well as those in need of Stephen Ministry care. Grant them peace and solace. O God, teach us your way.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of the seasons, we praise you for summertime, And we mourn that this year many hopes and expectations are denied. Give relief to those who suffer from the heat. Protect travelers from infection. Guard our children. Give rest to those with no vacation time. Hope to those who are unemployed. And patience to all who must endure this difficult time. O God, teach us your way.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, you are Abba, our loving Father. You are our sovereign of our lives, our Redeemer, the rock on which we build. Hear us as we offer the petitions of our hearts. O God, teach us your way.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of eternity, we praise you for all who have died in faith, especially this week, the apostles Mary Magdalene and James. We mourn our own beloved death. At the end, bring us all into the shining light of your presence. O God, teach us your way.
Lord, hear our prayer. Continue to offer our prayers of sympathy for Jean and Gordy at the death of Jean's mother, Arlie. We remember our nation in sorrow at the death of John Lewis. We lift up his life and his witness and his faith. Lead us in those ways. We pray for those who may be wandering or wondering, those who worry, and those who are weak in their life or their spirits. Sustain them and help us to walk with them in whatever way we are able to do during this coronavirus pandemic time. In certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless us now and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn is For the Fruit of All Creation, ELW 679.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need, awaken us to the needs of others, and at the end bring all the world to your feast, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God. We bid you a wonderful Sunday. If you're out in God's beautiful creation, we invite you to join us for Zoom at 10 and also returning for worship next Sunday at 9 a.m. Blessings and peace to all of you.